Are you ready?
Ready, Freddy.
Do I have to separate you two?
No.
He started it.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Under the bus. There it is. Right under.
There you go. Okay, so then at this time, I'll call to order the Suffern Central School District Board of Education meeting Tuesday, December 5th, 2017. Let the record reflect the time. The time is now 6:17. Thank you. Let the record reflect that all board members are present with the exception of Clark Osborne, who will not be here today. At this time, Chair, we entertain a motion to go into executive session for the purposes of one, discussing superintendent of schools employment agreement. Two, review with the attorney for the Board of Education legal issues pertaining to possible pilot agreement with Braemar Living. Three, review with the superintendent of schools and attorney for the Board of Education legal issues pertaining to position of clerk of the works. Four, review with the attorney for the Board of Education legal issues pertaining to Rockland Supreme Court review of decision of Board of Education superintendent suspension hearing matter. Five, review with the attorney for the Board of Education pending appeal to Commissioner of Education and pending immunization exemption matter. And six, reviewing with the attorney for the Board of Education legal issues pertaining to FOIL requests. Teresa.
So moved.
Excellent.
Monty?
Tommy. Second. Thank you. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Unanimous. Thank you.
This is a proxy permit?
Yes.
Okay.
Just things to take care of upstairs. Sometimes, you know, we get a little long-winded, but we have a packed agenda. So I do apologize. I know we have some great things going on tonight. So without further ado, if we could, we call to order the Suffern Central School District Board of Education meeting Tuesday, December 5th, 2017. The time is now.
Angela. 48.
Thank you. If we could all please stand for the pledge of allegiance.
The United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have a student report, front and center. Thank you.
Good evening. Here's what's going on at the high school. This Thursday, December 7th, is the National Honor Society induction. Friday, December 8th, there's a home hockey game at Sportorama at 7:30. Saturday, December 9th, there will be a pre-ACT held at the high school. Next Thursday, December 14th, is the winter concert, which features the symphonic band and orchestra along with the chorus. And short this week. So to wrap things up, I'd like to highlight some moments of giving back in honor of the holiday spirit. When I spoke to you last, my club, the Students Assisting Meals on Wheels Club, was finishing up their Thanksgiving food drive. We were able to successfully collect 100 cans this year of Gifts and Meals on Wheels. And lastly, yesterday, USO held a blood drive, and it was the most successful ever in Suffern history. The drive was in projection for 58 units to be collected, and they successfully registered 94 donors. Wow. 17 were deferred, 70 donated whole blood, and 7 people donated double red cell units on the ALYX machines, each counts as 2, for a total of 84 units.
That's
so
great.
We were able to collect a lot
that's
yesterday.
Great.
And that's all for tonight. I hope everyone has a wonderful new year and a happy holiday.
Thank you. Okay, 1.08 minutes of the regular meeting of November 21st, 2017. Chair, I'd entertain a motion to accept those minutes as so stated.
Mm-hmm.
Teresa, second?
Second.
Is that Tommy?
Yes. Really?
Sorry. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Unanimous. Okay, superintendent's comments, and I think we have some
Rich Foundation.
Rich Foundation things going on. Welcome.
And maybe some recipients.
Okay,
Rich
Foundation.
Yeah.
Good evening. The Rich Foundation is funding 27 out of the 33 applications we received this year. We are providing approximately $15,000 to further educational programming in Suffern Central. This includes a special contribution from the Ramapo Central Retired Teachers Association in the amount of $1,000. We received requests from 6 of the 7 schools in our district. In addition to teacher requests, this year we received applications from the Suffern Middle School Guidance Department, the school psychologist, and from the district's brand new pre-K program. Awards will be funding programs that reach pre-K, elementary, middle school, special education, art classrooms, FACS, and the Kindness Crusaders Club. We're funding innovative educational programming that's high-tech, such as robots, and low-tech, such as string art, and a variety of programs in between. Mindful breathing, smell therapy, sensory toys, and kids using their energy and activities like Fitbit to help fund UNICEF. Really exciting things will be happening in our district. For more information on tonight's awards, we invite you to speak with these teachers directly or stop by their tables this year at the STEAM Expo at Suffern High School on Saturday, March 3rd, where most of these projects will be on display. In an effort to keep things concise, I will simply state the names of the teachers who are receiving the grants and their schools. And after all the teachers have been named, I would ask that you please stand so that you can be recognized. Erin Murphy, Tara Belto from Cherry Lane, Andrea Edwards, Cherry Lane, Nicole McKenzie, Cherry Lane, Margaret DeStasso, Connor, Stephen Pashley, Connor, Dawn Bean, Connor, David Bramerstoff, Connor, Tricia Lanise, Connor, Donna Lapetito, Montebello, Eleanor Cerny, Montebello, Jennifer Cancro, Montebello, Renee Dawson, pre-K, Michelle McKiernan, Slotesburg, Millie Vega, Slotesburg, Joanne McDonough, Slotesburg, Teresa Dolan, Slotesburg, Liza Martin, Suffern Middle School, Beth Boning, Suffern Middle School, Nicole Tariq, Suffern Middle School, Cindy Miller, Suffern Middle School, Susan Wicks, Suffern Middle School, Gail Yodowitz, Suffern Middle School, Jennifer Butler, Viola, Cindy Reisenauer, Viola, Melanie O'Keefe, Viola, and Elizabeth Rolston, Viola. Would you all please stand?
I didn't acknowledge not only the Reach Foundation and the current board, but even the past boards.
Yep.
It's probably been one of the most important partnerships the district has with an organization, and they've done so much to further, you know, the excitement in the classrooms, and to give, you know, allow some of these programs that normally we would not be able to put money towards or provide or what have you. So it's, and aside from the money, if you've never seen the STEAM Expo, you are truly missing out, because was it 2 years, Ronnie, 2 years now? Truly underscores what Suffern Central Community is. So you really need to go, and there are people who drive 45 an hour to get to it. So it's kind of exciting. So it's maybe worldwide. We'll see. But again, thank you very much. You guys worked so hard to do this. And of course, you know, looking at all these programs, again, to the teachers, because, you know, you have to kind of think outside the box. You got to look at your class. What could I use? What could I, you know, where could I go and find these programs? Because like, my understanding is the teachers will find the programs and you know, file an application with Reach to try to get money for it. So definitely thank you for, you know, the effort that you do thinking outside the box, especially like I said, as you look at these programs. So thank you.
Johnny, did you get a picture?
I did. I got my picture.
Good job. Thank you again. Okay, Dr. Adams, any other comments?
No.
So we're at action items? Oh, no, wait, hold on. We're at public participation. This is public participation as to action items only. Those are the items that are behind me, 2.01 through 2.11. Correct?
Yes.
Through 2.11. The session will last 30 minutes. If you have any comment with respect to just those items, please step up to the podium, state your name, school affiliation, address your remarks to the board. Pursuant to policy 1230, 1400, 3240, you must refrain from commenting with respect to any particular staff, personnel, or student in the district. Action items. Okay, seeing none, I was not here to tell me if anybody's getting up.
Nobody's getting up.
Thank you, Teresa. I will close that portion of the meeting. So with respect to action items, I wasn't advised to pull any action items.
I just had a couple questions.
Just generic questions?
2.05 and 2.06, yeah, there are two questions.
Do you need to pull them, or you just
got a clarifying question? Yeah, just a question.
Clarifying questions? Mm-hmm. All right, so then we'll use a consent agenda with respect to 2.01 through 2.11. Chair, intend a motion to accept those as so stated. Teresa, second?
Second.
Amani, discussion? Amani, you had a couple questions, you said?
The vendors for the two trips are the same vendors that we've used in the past. Is there anything different?
No. The only thing that's different, and we had to change the contract when we first posted them last week, is they still had us down as Aramco Central.
Okay.
And Suffern Central.
They misspelled your name too.
And they misspelled it with two S's.
No.
Switched the two second pages. We think we have that corrected, but it's the same vendor that we've used in the past.
I just was wondering because it was in the agenda before.
Yes.
Okay. All right, that's all I need to ask.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Aye.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Before we move forward, we attended, where did they? Last night?
Yes.
Robin County School Board Association had a legislative dinner last night. Pretty quickly, all the assembly members were in presence, and all districts were represented by their school boards, as well as some PTA members and their superintendents. Most of them were there. Pretty much a big talk was about funding and possible state budget deficits this year that we need to keep an eye on and be aware of. The opioid epidemic was a big part of the discussion. We'll follow up with all the legislators. We're inviting them to our district as part of advocacy. I sent an email, as you recommended, as the board president recommended, that part of the report from November 21st is sent by email, but I haven't heard back yet, so we'd like to really follow up on the three recommendations made during the meeting, as well as the email follow-up that was
proposed. So you're going to have another advocacy meeting?
Not until January. We meet next in January, but right. Until then, we shouldn't wait until the next meeting. We should follow through on what we reported last time.
Right, but you have to
it's done.
And get it. Well, then you should then, well, I'll put it on the agenda then.
No, what we needed to do is actually a communication, as I explained in the last meeting, with the administration regarding whether reassessment of our poverty index would be beneficial to our district, with Mr. Teixeira, whether Lee and the rest of the administration feels that extra funding for a full day PK program would be beneficial. And so we need administrative feedback at this point.
Right, exactly. So take care of that and then report back to the board with respect to.
Okay, so I'm going to need to have administration schedule some time with, you know, members, you know, Matthew and Tom and myself.
All right, do a three-year committee.
So. Okay, perfect.
Okay, yeah,
thank you. And I, you know, asked for other items to be on the agenda that still didn't get on. I don't know what protocol we're using now, and I really need to hear back.
Okay, I did address those, but it's not on the agenda for today. So let's go.
Right.
Teresa has to leave today. Thanks. Sorry, she's not being rude. She does have to go somewhere. So
good night.
It was because the CSIP for the middle school, she's like, I'm out.
That's not true.
Only Matthew not having a nurse would have a baby girl.
Good night.
Happy holidays.
So I'm just hoping that we have a better arrangement with getting items on the agenda, because I've emailed.
We have a policy report, but we can address it after the meeting.
Great.
So 3.01, that would be the Suffern Middle School CSET by Mr. Fox.
I swear, I sent out one email. I did not pay anybody to be here. One sec. Screen. Otherwise, I'll ask Mr. Rizzo for assistance. Where are you? All right, Eric, it works. So, thank you for having me here tonight. I want to thank the Board of Ed, Dr. Adams, wherever he went, for allowing me to come here tonight and present about the middle school. I frequently introduce myself as the proud principal of Suffern Middle School. As you can see, I have a tremendous number of faculty members here on this dreary evening just to hear me drone on about the school, and I hope I do some of them justice here tonight. But we have a lot of really good things to impart to the board, as well as a little bit of more mundane data about the Comprehensive School Improvement Plan. I hope to keep it brief and succinct, although Mrs. Weber will tell you I failed miserably at that over the summer. We had a joint administrative retreat. I was tasked with saying presenting how great my school is in 8 minutes, and not even near enough time to talk about stuff in middle school, so I'm happy to fall with that task. You guys gotta invite me for the drinks. So one of the great things that we've been doing is we've been looking at the vision and mission of our school. Last year I presented a word cloud to the board with a lot of terms that have come up about what the faculty thinks and what some of our parents think about what a Suffern Middle School student should be. And we think this is a draft. Next time I present it to you, the word draft will probably be out of it. We still have a few versions we're looking at, but this one kind of encapsulates what we're looking for as sort of a vision and mission of our school. And Suffern Middle School strives to empower its students to take responsibility for achieving their personal best while inspiring lifelong learning. We think it ties in nicely with Educate for Personal Excellence as well. So that's just something I wanted to let you guys know is happening. A couple of other great things that are happening in our school have been the redesign of classrooms to more active learning environments. Some of you were able to come over in the summer and see these. We've, to date, redesigned 6 classrooms with the support of the board, Dr. Adams, Lee Weber, Steve Walker, Lisa Castaldo has certainly been involved as well. We've redesigned 3 science classrooms, 3 special education classrooms, and our library. And they've become more flexible learning spaces. Our library, for example, is completely wireless now. We don't have the obstructive computers and things mounted to the floor on that kind of obstruct kids from getting back and forth in the room. They're more collaborative environments. When you walk into these classrooms, you really see kids very engaged and moving around and being active, and that's what you really want to see in a middle school environment. So this year we're looking to redesign 4 more classrooms. Met with Ms. Martin in the ELA department. They're up next. We're going to go kind of more of an English route this time to see what we can do. We've also posted a lot of these photos on our Instagram account. We're on Instagram now in addition to Twitter, so you can see some of our stuff on there too. Just some of the other great stuff that's going on. We've had a long-standing partnership with our PTA. They provide us with over $10,000 a year to fund our character education assemblies and events that we have in the school. 8th grade on the left had Mark Merrow. He's a former professional wrestler who had some bad times in his life and talks to students about being against destructive decisions. On the right-hand side, we have Tom Thalen here, talks to our 7th graders about how they can make themselves victim-proof and really take ownership of their own behavior. And in the middle, it was really kind of an incredible event. Mrs. Castaldo and Cheryl Valenti helped bring the Kindness campaign, the Kind campaign, to our school last year. And the founders of the Kind campaign actually came to our school. That's Lauren and Molly. They only go to about, what, maybe 60 schools a year. They travel the world. Mrs. Gustavo twisted their arm a little bit, told them how great Suffern Middle School was. And they showed up. It was their the last stop on their world tour. So it was really an amazing event. And, you know, it's great to get that kind of, not only that kind of recognition, but that kind of participation. And just to refresh the board on some of the other things that are so great about our school, that are long-standing things, we have our extended core classes. Our core classes are 53 minutes long. Our encore programs offer students a wide variety of exploratory courses. We brought back some courses this year, and we have some new courses this year. We brought Habit back, very popular elective in our school. And Mrs. Yodowitz is here, right? Teaching some Habit this year, right? Advancement via individual determination. Leads up well into our high school elective. Excalibur, I'm not going to remember what that acronym stands for. I think I have it written down here. That is our 8th grade video game design elective. Mrs. Sheehy is teaching. So we have two groups of 8th graders in two sections that are working in teams to develop video games. Right now, to code the video games, to market them, everything from its design, its inception, to hopefully selling it at some point. I'm not sure where the money goes if they sell it, but hopefully selling it at some point. And also with the support of the board, we have a skill-based program for some of our ELL students, our English language learners, after school. It's really a language acquisition program and a literacy program for those students to help them integrate into the academic environment at our school. We run that 4 days a week now, so that's been really going very well. A couple of other things just to kind of remind you before I get to some of the more boring data. One of the things that's really incredible about our middle school is nearly 43% of our 7th and 8th grade kids are in accelerated classes. So those are kids who are taking accelerated math and science, and by 8th grade, some of them have taken anywhere from 1, 2, to 3 readings exams by the time they get to high school. I know that's not an opportunity I had when I was in middle school, although that was back in the dark ages, but the incredible thing about the faculty that gets these students and there are times I give students opportunities in this program who are motivated students who are kind of on the line of getting in the program, but our teachers take those kids, and as you can see, 95% of them score mastery. So that's 85 or above on all those risks, algebra, geometry, and learning environment. So we really do have some fantastic opportunities for students to excel in our school if they choose to do so. We have some unique instruction. The top two things certainly were taking part. One of the reasons I'm kind of focusing on ELA this year is to give them some rooms that are kind of better for some of the instruction they're doing. The 20 percentile projects, I'm sure you heard about them from the high school. We had kids doing those last year. The 7th grade ELA teachers kind of sent them off to me to do something community-based, good for their community. And my email box filled up with emails from kids wanting to meet with me about things they wanted to do. And it was incredible. I was the guy that had to introduce them to the word bureaucracy, though, because some of them realized that their principal is not all-powerful, and I do not control the athletic fields, I don't control things 24-7, so they had to fill out building use forms, things like that, and that kind of drove the business office slightly crazy, too, but it was a real good learning experience for all those students. We still have escape rooms going on where kids figure things out, they problem-solve, their way to a solution, and it's great. They sent me the pictures of the kids who solved it in a certain time frame. Our 7th grade science teachers are still involved in doing flipped education in their classrooms. Some of the videos you look at are, you know, it's like our own Khan Academy here. And the kids watch those at night and come in ready to go. We have an encore program that's really second to none. Despite, you know, what you hear on the news or whatever has happened here in Radical Central in the past, we have, I think, probably the strongest encore program of any middle school in the area. The opportunities our kids have for music, not just band, orchestra, and chorus, which is fantastic, but our kids can take digital music, our kids can take guitar, our kids can come in the morning and perform in show choir. We run two musicals, one for 6th grade, one for 7th and 8th grade. There's a very strong community support for the arts and music in this community. Great opportunities in world language, lots of options there. Our family and consumer science teachers, we still teach kids things like financial literacy and how to cook, how to be self-sufficient, be responsible for their own nutrition. And one of the things I think people don't realize because, I think the focus on STEAM is incredible in the district now. But at the middle school, that's been going on really for the last 15 or 16 years. Our Gateway to Technology program based on Project Lead the Way was in place before I got to the middle school. Every kid in the middle school takes that course with few exceptions. Now they take it for 50 weeks across 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. So we've added to that course over the years. So at Suffern Middle School, it's just part of our DNA. It's not a special course we have to add. It's not a special space we have to add. It's something our kids do. We've added 3D printers to the program. The technology teachers, I know Dr. Adams and I were in the classes today. We were playing Shark Tank today, judging some inventions, whether or not we should invest.
I think you made a pretty good offer today.
I think Mr. DeFabio and I got the business, but anyways. So I have to really kind of, you know, just I like to refresh everybody on the really good stuff that's going on. And I probably only touched on a fraction of it. So I apologize if I missed anybody here, but I am out of time. So getting to the CSIP. We do use NWA MAP at the middle school, much like all the other schools, much like the elementary schools. We use it as a measure. It's really our only objective growth measure, or one of our objective growth measures that every kid in the school takes. As you know, our data from state assessments hasn't been real solid because we have a pretty high opt-out rate. I think our refusal rate was somewhere around 60% last year. So we really have gotten used to using our own measures, whether it be NWA MAP, whether it be Achieve 3000, READ 180, local assessments. I'm always of mind that our teachers kind of know best how to get our students to grow in literacy and math. So we're looking really for a 5% increase across all grades. 60% of our students met their projections. On the next slide, I'll show you, I kind of overshot my projections a little bit, but our grades are making their growth projections for the year, and in most cases are exceeding them. Just to remind everyone, we do have three literacy providers, one in each grade, that provide targeted interventions in pullouts and push-in classes. We have other teachers that provide those services as well. We do use Achieve 3000 to help bring student reading levels and nonfiction up, as we know they're getting ready to go to high school, and that's important for them in high school as well. And READ 180 we really use in more of our learning center programs for kids who need a little bit more intensive support. So we get really good data out of those models as well. And I'll show you exactly why I kind of set this around 5%. I got a little overconfident, I think, this past year. The blue line is the projected growth after the students take NWA MAP in the fall. The red line is the observed growth at the end of the year in the spring. And the gold line is the principal growth, because I was very overconfident. I thought the kids could actually go way past it. I thought I was smarter than the computer program. Apparently, I'm not. So you can see sixth grade just about made their target. They were about 2/10 of a point off. But seventh and eighth grade certainly exceeded their growth targets in reading on the NWA MAP and reading. So that certainly means to me that our kids are moving in the right direction. And we use this really to help inform teachers as to where areas of weakness for kids are. It's by no means the only measure we use. We never place a kid, whether it be in honors, AIS, or anything else, just based on NWA MAP. We always use multiple measures in order to do that. And the other thing I looked at this year was interesting. We always look at Lexile when we talk about Achieve 3000, but the reports that came through last year linked Achieve 3000 to New York State College and Career Standards. And it gave us a metric for seeing if our kids are on track, approaching the standards, or really exceeding the standards. In September, we had about 28.5% of our kids who were meeting or exceeding the standards already. By the end of the year, nearly 50% of our kids were meeting or exceeding standards. And the green also means kids are accelerating towards meeting those standards as well. So that was nice, because they tie that to college and career readiness standards, which are important for student success in high school as well. So it was a nice increase there. So I thought that's a new stat for me to show to the board this year. We get a number of different data points from Achieve, but this was we thought was a good one. Our literacy folks, I think, are doing a great job in getting our kids to grow and be ready for high school or beyond. Our math. We're just a fantastic math school. I don't really know how else to say it. I mean, we're great at everything I think we do. Math, I think if all our kids were taking the state assessments, the last time our sixth grade took it, we were 12th in the state, just to give you an idea, the whole state. So 72% of our students met or exceeded their NWA math projections this past year. That's, I don't think I've ever seen it that high for middle school. I do have an increase in achievement by 8% for next year. I think that's reasonable because I overshot, but you'll also see the kids really nearly came up to my growth projections in math. We do have a skills lab. We have two teachers working at skills lab this year. And Mrs. DiMartino, one of our sixth grade math teachers, and Mrs. Rout, one of our world language ENL teachers, are teaching a collaborative class for ENL students in math this year to really bring their skills up to the point where hopefully they can integrate into their regular math class as well. It's a multi-grade class. So the teachers really, those two teachers really took on a tremendous challenge, and they're doing a fantastic job with that as well. We don't lean on our computer-based interventions too much. We really, really don't need too much in the way of computer-based interventions in math. We do have Math 180 for some of our self-contained students, and some of our teachers still use IXL. And under the guidance of Dr. Law, our math coordinators are working with our math teachers to continue to align our curriculum with what New York State's calling the next gen standards. So it's math. I was a little over the goal, the goal line is me, but you can see the growth projections, the observed growth is far more than the growth projections. If a whole grade goes up by three or more, that's really pretty amazing. And here we have it pretty much across almost all grades showing growth in math. And like I said before, 95% for the 40 or so percent that take the readings exams. It's just, yes.
Rather than go back on them. Sure. It's okay. So those figures, whether the English language or the math, include our ENL population?
It includes the entire population of the school. The only kids it may not include are kids who just arrived in the country who can't access the program. But in math, it should include them because there is a Spanish version of it. In math, there's the multilingual aspects of that. So math, I think, is even more inclusive than the literacy one.
So they're able to take the math exam in their native language?
They can, yes, they can, absolutely.
And some of our students do?
Absolutely, yes. We have, as a matter of fact, I just ordered our state assessments, Spanish, Haitian, Creole, Russian right now. So,
awesome.
So we have multiple languages for that. That's math. We continue to do what we do for our LAIS bullying prevention program. I'm not even sure, I was just talking to my administrators before this, I'm not even sure we should call it that anymore. Only because LAIS has really provided us with the framework, but we've had a dedicated committee of teachers writing lessons for the program. They tweak it every year. It's really a Suffern Middle School bullying prevention program at this point with an LAIS survey. We still do our class meetings, our character building assemblies. We still want to decrease students feeling afraid of being bullied, and we want to decrease students being bullied. But I have a really nice stat to show you after this. I think Ms. Castaldo has done a great job of tracking incidents that have not risen to the level of administrative referral so that we're catching some of these things and trying to track some of these things before it gets to that point. Our counselors and our clinical staff have done a great job integrating with us and teachers in order to do that. And we always have a positive focus. Our assemblies are really to encourage kids to exhibit positive behaviors. It's not, you're wrong. It's, here's what you can do. And that's kind of where we're at, I think, as a school. Between the KIND campaign, Girls on the Run, certainly Mrs. Weber, Mrs. Mena, Mrs. Brout this past spring did it, Mrs. Clara, Mrs. Wicks did it this fall. It was a great character program for young ladies in our school, too, and they ran. We've had two groups run the 5K. Now, as a result of it, did I miss anybody who approached that? Monaco. Sorry, Monaco. I apologize. So, this is Monaco. I'm getting older. You gotta give me a little bit. And I mentioned the other speakers and what they spoke about before. But one of the great things about the survey is it tells us kids coming to school and if they fear being bullied in school. So back in 2012 when we started surveying students, you can see particularly the girls, we were very close to the national average. And that national average changes every year. It's based on a few hundred thousand students who take the all-day survey every year. So, one of the reasons we focused on girls last year, and one of the reasons that Mrs. Castaldo kind of took that on this past year, We were really having trouble driving that blue bar down to the point where girls felt more comfortable coming to school. And it really kind of is a sobering statistic when you think that, you know, hundreds of thousands of students have taken the survey and nearly half of them, 45% of them, fear going to school if they're a girl. So
national average what year?
That's actually this year. National average is this year. And you can see that from last year to this year, you know, we scratch our heads, we go back, we tweak things, we brought in some new things, and, you know, we were able to get that number lower. You know, we have less girls feeling afraid of coming to school, we have less boys feeling afraid of being bullied in school. So, and that speaks to the climate, it speaks to how hard the teachers work to promote a positive environment in school, and to the PTA support of our programs at our school. It's one of the things I think I'm most proud of over the last 10 years. This is my 10th year as principal. I find that hard to believe, but. I projected a 3% decrease. The actual decrease was 6% overall, but it was a 9% decrease for young ladies feeling fear of being bullied at Suffern Middle School. And the survey is given at a research-based time that, you know, we can't get it too close to the vacations, things like that. You know, we don't give it on a day where they're having parties in school, so, sorry guys, we have parties sometimes. Parties like a day before, you know, maybe day before Christmas break or something like that, and everybody's feeling good about themselves. You know, Dr. Kagan is kind of taking ownership and making sure we give those surveys at the right time, too. And one of the things that was really amazing last year was the Kind campaign. There were over, every girl in the school was in the auditorium. The group of teachers that are up there on the top left help run it. Some of them are here tonight. It was so powerful. I was hiding in the sound booth. I was the only guy that got to see it. So don't tell the girls that. They didn't know. The teachers knew I was there. The girls, I don't think, knew I was there. But it was very powerful. It really was an event that helped young ladies think about how to build themselves up instead of tearing themselves down or tearing each other down. And the teachers shared their experiences, which was incredibly powerful for the students to hear how they may have been bullied in school, but how they've overcome it. And you just look at the range of teachers that are up there. I mean, from some of the younger teachers we have in the school to probably the oldest teacher in the district, right? And I'm not saying that in that, it's Mrs. Bitty. Mrs. Bitty's been here. She's been here longer, I think, than anybody. 50 years. We have the Kind wall. I know I saw Mrs. Mena and Mrs. Nordone kind of constructing our new Kind wall this year. Kids offer apologies about the kinds of things they could do to make things better. So it was a tremendous event. Mrs. Castaldo did a survey afterwards to see how the girls felt about it. She provided some questions for them. The most interesting thing that came out of it was much more impactful for the sixth grade girls than the seventh and eighth grade. At least that's how they responded, right? So this year we did it in October, and we started with the sixth grade girls because every girl in the school had it already. And I think that's going to be kind of a theme for us moving forward. If we do this moving forward, we're going to do it with the sixth grade girls first. And it kind of makes sense that it would have more impact on them at that age. So hopefully, maybe some of you have heard of it, maybe some of you have daughters in our school that came home and talked about it. We hope it sparks a good conversation. Just really one last thing in terms of social-emotional. I think I mentioned to the board last year that we did such a great job of driving our attendance numbers down that I was kind of afraid, you know, we'd gotten it pretty much as low as it could go. A few years ago, we had some teachers get together and form a committee to help clearly articulate a policy for parents to reference for our attendance. Our team leaders really helped to take ownership of this. We've made lots of calls, more calls than we ever had before, more home visits than we've ever made before, and we're trying to monitor as best we can those students who are chronically absent, meaning 10 days or more out of school. So here are the numbers for this past year. Went up a little bit from 4.4% to 5.2%. We do have the highest turnover rate of students in the district. One third of our building obviously turns over every year. Each group definitely presents with their own challenges, but I think our attendance, particularly if you look at students over 18 days out, we made a lot of headway there. And it's not a large number of kids, but those were kids who really were missing a lot of school. So we've really focused on the kids, you know, from the right on over. So that's why I only set it at 1%. I kind of hope to drive it down slightly below where I had it last year. But you know, it's been ongoing. We have a 95% attendance rate. And I think that's also linked to the climate. Less kids feeling a fear of being bullied in school means more kids want to come to school on a daily basis. And I think that's what we're seeing with our attendance. And you can see 3 or 4 years ago, it was much higher in terms of kids who missed 10 or more days, we were, you know, around 9%. So we're still looking to drive that down. A couple of final points. I just wanted to talk to the board a little bit about what I spoke to my faculty about opening day this year. Because I had to give a presentation about how wonderful my school was, I kept thinking, I had seen the Central Element Schools to Watch for several years. So what this is it's a national movement and a state movement to recognize middle schools, to recognize innovative middle schools who show really good progress in four areas. And those areas are academic excellence, developmental responsiveness, social equity, organizational structures and processes. So we went through kind of a checklist that they give you to see if your school is ready for this, and pretty much everybody came back and said, you know what, we do all this stuff already. We really might be ready for this. So what this does is it provides you with a rubric to review your school. It's a research-based rubric put out by the New York State Middle School Association and the National Forum to Accelerate Middle Grade Reform. And it gives you something to look at in order to rate and improve your programs. It focuses on your areas of strength and your areas of weakness. So I told my faculty at our opening day faculty meeting, I said, I think this is the time. I'm not doing this to get a feather in my cap. I don't think I need that. But I think other people need to know how great our middle school is too, outside of just Suffern Central. So what I did was I formed a steering committee that I'm certainly going to get back to. On one of our extended days, each group of teachers got together in their department and they rated each area in that rubric. And I'm going to present that data, the faculty doesn't know this yet, I'm going to present that data to them at our December faculty meeting in a couple of weeks. We're going to look at areas of strength, we're going to look at areas that need improvement, and we're going to determine whether or not we want the schools to watch people to come in and evaluate our school. If they do, they may decide, hey, you're a school to watch, you're a great school, we want to recognize you. If they don't, we'll have areas that we can focus on and improve. So that's kind of my goal, to put something in place like this, which really meshes well with the CSIP that Dr. Adams brought to us several years ago. So this could really be something good to inform what we do in the school in the future. And you can see it's got wide support. Everyone from NYSU to NYSED supports this initiative. I did link the rubric on there. I'm not sure if you have the actual Google slide, but if you ever want to take a look at it, you can just Google Central Element Schools to Watch. And finally, I hope I didn't go over my time here. I might have. What's that?
A little bit.
A little bit, sorry. Say it again. I can't do it. Finally, Mrs. Tarifi, I don't know if she's here or not, and her kindness crusaders have once again shown everything that's great about our school. What started out as what I thought was kind of a one-off, 1 year, is now going into year four. We actually met today to discuss what the students wanted and Mrs. Tarifi wanted this year. But I'll show you a little bit of it since I went over. I don't necessarily want to. Oh, Eric, do you want to? Yeah. Thank you.
Year three looked very good.
What's that?
Year three was amazing.
Oh, it's over there. Go. Oh, over there. Okay. The board goes over. There it is.
You like that sign?
Yes. GTA, of course. GTA.
Thank you.
So there's a little more at the end with the credits for you guys.
The aerial shot, was that a drone shot?
Yes, it was a drone. That's a former student too, I believe, that runs the drone company.
That's really awesome.
Apologize for not asking for approval ahead of time, but I figured if I was going to get in trouble, why get Dr. Adams in trouble? So, that was actually a drone. Yeah, it was great. I'm glad the weather cleared up for us. So, how can you not be proud of that and everything?
We need to use this as a commercial.
Absolutely.
Yeah, just post it on our district site. We really have to put
it out. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's incredible.
I think it's, I mean, we have, I thought we had it. I mean, we certainly have it on our social media, but yeah.
Yeah, we need to really have more and more outside. Yeah,
can't wait for this year.
See how wonderful.
So thank you. I apologize for going a little over my time. And gosh, I can't believe how many teachers came. Thanks for coming, guys.
Thank you. Okay, so next we have transportation.
Transportation.
This is my soul week. That is one tough act to follow. Yeah. I didn't see the big applause for transportation. So we're just going to do a little review of our student transportation. We do this every year. Rena Gessler was supposed to be here tonight. She's takes care of all these kids every day, but she has strep throat today, so staying home was a good idea. We just want to review again. This is about a little bit more the number of kids that we transport this year to about the same number of schools. But you see what a big, big undertaking this is to transport over 5,000 children to 104 schools. And you know, I know people get upset with us sometimes, but it really is a big undertaking, and considering how many children you're transporting, we really don't have that many issues. This is just a comparison from a few years ago, 2011-12, to currently, and you can see the number of non-public schools has increased tremendously. Last year we transported to 69 non-public schools. The special education actually one less this year. But we also have 12 schools, which seems to always be, we have 10 or 12 schools that are waiting to be approved because they're missing fire inspections, certificates of occupancy or bed numbers, which is something that the board instituted part of our policy to make sure that these things are all in place before we start transporting children that live in Suffern Central to these schools. Come on, baby. There you go. These are just some of the schools that, like I said, are pending to the different issues. Some of them, Ataris, Central UTA, and the one underneath, the Visnitz, are three schools that we've been going back and forth with, especially Central UTA. We've been having back and forth with the village, trying to get everything in place so that we can start transporting to these schools. We're not trying to give different schools a hard time, but we just want to make sure our children are safe when they're at those schools. This is something a little new, because I don't think people really realize how many vehicles we have on the road at any time. But you see, to those 104 schools, we have 79 vehicles. A lot, mostly large buses, some cars, vans, wheelchair vans. But on a daily basis, we do 444 bus routes. Yeah, those numbers are huge numbers. Last year we started using BOCES, and this year we actually have more students being transported through BOCES. Part of that is it's to be efficient. We were saving some money doing it, but it's a little bit more efficient because before we were sending one or two kids on a bus on a route, now we get it together with BOCES and makes it efficient for everybody within the county. I wanted to bring this back because part of our plan was to make some changes to transportation based on the laws. We went upstate last year. If you remember, we met with New York State to make sure that what were our rules, what could we change, how do we make transportation better and safer, and make sure we're doing the right thing for our students. So these are some of the changes that we made last year. We used to provide transportation on any days that any school is open, and that provided a lot of problems because if we were closed,
I know Rena sometimes would get calls trying to do a two, make her own rules of a two-hour delay or closing one of their schools or stopping the transportation. To the stop that, and because our neighbor to the east was actually doing the same thing, we decided we're only going to transport on days that we're available to supervise that transportation. We also, which was a big change for us, was to provide transportation for one arrival and one dismissal. We got a lot of pushback on that, but we stayed with that because we were going to schools at 7:30, 8 o'clock, 8:30, and the same thing on the way home, transporting four or five kids. It was much, much more costly and much harder to do. As you see, with 444 routes already, we didn't need to add, you know, multiple for some of these other schools. We also only sending people to one location, one beds number. We wanted to ensure that their beds number was listed with New York SED because some of them were actually what they call feeder sites. And when I first heard the word feeder site, I'm like, oh, it's just like a satellite. No, these were actually schools that all they did was feed kids. So we actually learned a lot in this whole process. And the same thing, the most important part is to make sure that they have valid beds numbers, which means New York State has approved them, that they have the fire inspection and the certificate of occupancy. The biggest cost savings for us is the one arrival, one dismissal, which last year saved us about $130,000, and this year about $150,000 is what we're projecting. I'm not saying transportation costs aren't going up, because they are, but this, they would have been higher. Then we looked at how much our this is our estimated for 17-18, which is it's a changing number. We're adding schools, we add more students, usually adding, not subtracting. But it's interesting to note that of the 4,000 children that we're transporting for regular education, it's about $662 per child. Obviously, part of that is because everybody's located in one area. Special education is always more costly because a lot of times you have monitors on the bus and sometimes special buses, vans, or whatever to do. But non-public transportation is $2,850 per child. That's a really large number. And a lot of it is because even though we've reduced the number of routes we're taking and the number of times, there's still a lot involved here. And we have a small number of students. We could be sending three students to one school, two students to another school.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but the special education per student is 11,188 in spite of using the BOCES buses.
Yeah, because a lot of times there's monitors on the buses, and that's costly for the children.
That's why the cost is up. Mm-hmm.
And this is just a little bit of a graph to show you the same sort of thing. To show you in 15-16, before we changed our program, and now in 17-18, the number of miles we're traveling each day for kids. So you see that the biggest point here is the non-public, since we reduced to the one arrival, one dismissal, we're actually doing less miles with a lot more children. 66 more children since 15-16, yet the miles per day are down, and that's because of that. We're not running to the same school three, four, or five times a day. Now this graph also shows you the cost per student. It's just again showing you over 2 years what the difference is in just showing that $150,000 savings that we want you to see, but in a little graph format. And I found this very interesting when I threw it into a pie chart, because you can really see that even though the percentage of our students, 81% are regular education students transported to our 7 schools, the cost is only 38%. Where, and we know special education is what it is, but look at the non-public. Even though that it's 15% of the students, oops, I can't read it, it's too dark. 30%. So that's a big difference. You see that we have, even though we've cut down, we still spend a lot of our budget on transporting non-public students. And lastly, we just wanted to show you some of the dates that we go through. As you know, early March, you guys get a transportation handbook, which we update with different things. This year, it's going to say Suffern Central, and that's one big update, just for your approval. But also, we send out multiple emails, multiple letters to all the non-public schools in the area telling them, we're having a meeting here, and we're going to go through this handbook and explain everything, all our changes, what the rules are. We hardly have anybody ever show up. But we try very hard, and as Dr. Adams has been very instrumental in us really going out of our way in all different ways to communicate with the non-public schools so that they understand what our rules are, what our changes are, and how we operate here at Suffern Central. This year was the first real year that we have really stuck to that April 1st deadline, because it becomes a real nightmare trying when people were just adding kids left and right. I mean, we have a lot of kids that are being added anyway, just people are moving into the area. But when people want to change schools or change their times, it just became a little bit out of control. So hopefully next year will be a little bit smoother, because they realize we're not kidding with that April 1st deadline, which actually is the state deadline. It's not like we made up something. But also it helps us a little bit finalizing our budget, because we vote on a budget a month later, and really the board votes on the budget mid to late April. You want to have an idea of how many kids are going to be transported. And which is really a good thing, every month we have a school bus driver meeting here. All the bus drivers from Chestnut Ridge come here, and it's been really helpful that many administrators and many principals come in, they speak to them, any kind of issues they're having, the drivers speak to us. It just has been very good to have a really good rapport with these drivers. Because after all, they do transport our kids, and the most important thing is to get there safely, to get there on time. So that's all I have. I don't know if you have any questions for me. Not too specific, Green is not here.
Okay, I'm sure you're already looking at this, but we've trimmed a big trim over the past year. Mm-hmm. What other areas can we trim at?
I think if we continue to utilize BOCES as much as we can, that's definitely helping us. But I don't think, I mean, we're always going to be going up, because, I mean, we're based on CPI to begin with, but because the non-public, as you see, is $2,800 a kid, and that's just increasing, there's only so much that our hands are kind of tied. There's only so much we can do. But we look at everything we can do to trim that budget.
Thank you very much.
Anybody else?
Thanks, Teresa.
I know it's exciting as, you know, yes. Ending in a video.
Okay, PPS Innovations. In entourage.
Well, we don't have anyone to clap for us.
I know. We got a big break.
I'm sorry.
We have a bag for a pillow.
I know. It would last, and it's 10 to 9. Sorry, guys. So, I have with me, of course, my entourage. So, Ms. Tara Rivera. She's supervisor of elementary special services. You need to wait. They don't know who you are. I got Ms. Sybil Jeffs. She's our supervisor of elementary and Ms. Courtney Violetti. Can you all hear me? Okay, so we want to talk to you about PPS innovations for this year. So just a quick recap about what PPS covers. We cover everything in those, and it left some of the words out. We couldn't get a Wordle or whatever you call this thing, because Taryn built it for me. She's my expert on this kind of stuff, to fit all of the words of what we cover. So basically anything that isn't gen ed or curriculum is what PPS covers, people personnel services. And then when there's something extra that comes up new, we cover that too, and it just gets chucked in there. So we do things like homeless students, foster care, Medicaid, all of the related services like counseling, speech, OTPT, nursing, if I didn't mention it already, Part 154, all vision, all behavioral supports, and of course, all special ed falls under people personnel services. So we have a lot of different focuses that we have in PPS because we have so many different areas we cover.
So under the social emotional umbrella, these are some of the new initiatives that we have district wide. So TCI, which stands for Therapeutic Crisis Intervention, and now CPI, we've moved over to CPI, and that stands for Crisis Prevention and Intervention. Is essentially a training for staff that teaches them nonviolent crisis intervention techniques. And they're taught to safely de-escalate any potentially disruptive or heightened situations. The next one on the list is DBT, which is Dialectical Behavioral Therapy. This is an initiative K-12. It's actually district-wide. The training started primarily with our school psychologists and social workers, but it's also been infused into our therapeutic support programs. It's a form of cognitive therapy, and it teaches students to focus on mindfulness, self-regulation skills, coping skills, and strategies. The next one, Mental Health First Aid, is actually a training that was provided for our special education monitors and aides district-wide. It's a 5-step action plan that they can use to offer help to young people when they're showing signs of either a mental illness or crisis. And the next one is mindfulness. So mindfulness is actually a component of DBT, Dialectical Behavioral Therapy. But it's actually something that many of the schools are focusing on even outside of this therapy. And essentially what it is bringing awareness to your senses, to your state of mind. And it's something that has started as part of this therapy with a psychologist, but it's actually for everyone. So all students, you know, they don't have to be necessarily in any type of program. They can access this in all buildings.
I think we're going to give you a sampling.
So I'm sure you found it all interesting that you were given a raise and if you were part of the board. And one of the things that we did in PPS is run a mindfulness 3-hour training for all of the lunch monitors who were not in the CPR training that was done. So there were 10 of them in CPR, that's all CPR can fit. All the rest of the lunch monitors, literacy aides, and some of the monitors were with us in a mindfulness activity. So I'd like you to just look at that raising for a minute. And we're going to start practicing mindfulness. Pretend that you have never seen a raisin before. And Brian, I'm really hoping you didn't eat yours because I saw you wanted to.
I was close.
I saw. And I thought of that marshmallow activity with the 2-year-old.
I was close.
And you know, and how they say that you can withstand the impulse to eat it. And here you are going after the raisin. But anyway, pretend you've never seen a raisin before. Ponder that raisin and pay careful attention to the way the raisin looks, how it feels, how its skin responds to its manipulation, its smell, and its taste. Now jot down some notes to share. Well, it's really nice to see that all the board is jotting down notes. And Lee is jotting down notes with her perfect pencil over there, which, by the way, Sybil loves as well. She's a mathematician. Perfect pencils, she said it to us the other day. So, we started our activity with the monitors like that. If anybody has anything to share, please do so. I'm not going to force anyone. We had a really great time with the monitors on that activity, and we taught them 4 others that they could use with the students at times like indoor recess or when they're outside with students and there's conflict, there's behavioral issues. So guys, there's packets there you can hand out so the board can see the rest. We have packets of the rest of the activities we did with the monitors. So one was the raisin exercise to get them in the right frame of mind. We also did the 5 senses exercise with them where you notice 5 things you see, notice 4 things you feel, notice 3 things you can hear, 2 things you can smell, and 1 thing you can taste. And you can see where the monitors can use that. And the next 2 activities that are in the packet, including one about writing things about the ABCs, to kind of center students and get them back to themselves during recess activities. So we were really proud of that particular piece of PD that we did this year. Upcoming in the socio-emotional area for PPS is the Socio-Emotional Learning Steering Committee, which we've been tasked to form from Dr. Adams. And this will be based on some work that we've seen done at the Yale Center, which focuses on mindfulness and other techniques to help students behaviorally and socio-emotionally. Part of the steering committee will be charged with forming a socio-emotional learning charter for the district. What do we want our students to feel like when they're here, and how are we going to get there? So that will be the major work of that committee, which will start in the spring. Physically, what has PPS done for physical safety and security this year. We made sure we reauthorized the district safety plan. All of the emergency response plans for all of the buildings were reauthorized and updated as well. This year, all of the AEDs were replaced. The majority of them were up. We replaced all of them at the same time, so we were then on the same time schedule with that. We provided CPR training, and we will be doing that again in the future. And through our services and nursing services, we now have a student with a service dog in one of our buildings. So we kind of really worked on the what was that?
Shaq?
Yes, Shaq.
Shaq is awesome.
In the middle school, Shaq is awesome. We developed a protocol. I have a whole binder of the training the dog has gone through and certified. So we're really proud of that as well. Instructionally.
Good evening, everybody. So, we've been working on last summer we had a 3-day summer institute. One of our instructional focuses this year has been explicit instruction. Dr. D. Berlinghoff worked with members of our teaching staff over 3 days in the summer to train them in methods of explicit instruction. Explicit instruction is the most effective research-supported method for instructing students with disabilities. The co-teach reboot has been another focus of PPS this year. Dr. Berlinghoff returned to Suffern Central in October to train our co-teach teams in the most effective methods of co-teaching, which includes scaffolding, instruction for students, as well as strong teacher collaboration. Dr. Berlinghoff will be pushing into many of our co-teach classes next week in order to observe and offer suggestions for improvement to the teams that she'll be working with. As an extension of last year's RTI focus, PPS leaders are assisting building administration and faculty in identifying and addressing students' needs through the RTI process. This work will continue into the upcoming Summer Institute we are planning for June. The Special Education Department at Suffern High School has been working collaboratively to incorporate executive functioning skills to the co-teach support classes. We're working together to teach students various skills that they can use in Suffern High School and in the world beyond, and to make our students college and career ready. This work will continue past this school year. This year in PPS, we are now using the BVAT, or the Bilingual Verbal Abilities Test, as an assessment to identify students who require a bilingual evaluation, either for initial eligibility for special education services or for a reevaluation. The BVAT is currently available in 25 languages other than English, and we are using right now the Spanish version for our students. The New York State Education Department is focusing on dyslexia currently, and they are developing the use of the Shaywitz Dyslexia Screener. This is used primarily at early elementary grades in combination with subtests from other assessments such as the Wyatt and the Woodcock-Johnson Test of Achievement to determine what students' needs are in that area.
Okay, also newly implemented this year is our Foundations program. So at Cherry Lane Elementary, we have Early Foundations, and at the middle school, we have Foundations. These classes were built to support the students' development of functional skills within literacy and mathematics, as well as working on the core instruction, content, and curriculum. They also focus a lot on social skills, communication, also for the younger ones, some kitchen play and getting in there and communicating with them in different play areas. We have a board-certified behavior analyst that also works closely with our teachers and related service providers to best guide their instruction and their group work. And so far, it's going really well. We've got some feedback from both teachers, other staff in our buildings, and the parents that they're very happy with the experience, especially the parents of students coming back from out-of-district placements that are now in their home school and working within the community, maybe on the school musical, clubs, or activities. And we're going to dive deeper into that in the next slides.
Okay, so one of the things we wanted to talk a little bit about is how do we build something like new classes? How do we build that new program? Why that new program? So the steps we went through. 6 simple steps weren't that simple when we were going through it. First, we evaluated the need. What were we considering? And this we started probably at about last year this time, believe it or not, a year ahead of time. We had had a lot of parent requests, particularly at the late elementary, early middle school level, for district classes for populations with specific needs that weren't handled here in the district. We have parents, and at times, and we just heard how much the busing cost, we had parents complaining about students who were on buses for half an hour or more going to programs that we really could do in district. So we first were considering that. We wanted to create capacity through the increased class offerings. How many more students can we have here? And increase our support for cognitive and behavioral issues. And of course, there were budget implications. Just as with the busing, there's budget implications. Each BOSU's placement costs, you know, quite a bit more than an in-house placement for students. Our solution was to create classes that supported the continued development of foundational skills in literacy and math while giving exposure to content and curriculum and mainstream integration opportunities. So that's why we created the two classes we did. In order to do that, we needed more than just PPS. Myself and the three lovely ladies behind me could not completely do this on our own.
Okay, so, so collaboration is very important. And we worked with the building administration in order to find classrooms first that would allow integration and accessibility for those students, as well as identify dedicated professionals who have a passion for working in these types of programs. And we were able to work together in order to find that.
So we began dialogue with the families, and again, this is a new class, so it was not necessarily a program that we could take families to go see. So it was important to be able to really share all the information about the classes. We wanted to make sure that families were active members in the process, and we wanted to make sure that they understood all the critical components that were involved. So this is a sampling. We created this flyer for families. We actually mailed it home. We called families. We went through it. We wanted to provide a snapshot of what the program would look like. We wanted to give them contact information in case they had questions. And we wanted to show them, you know, what the program features would be, so that it, by the time we got to the meeting, they at least felt like they had some background information on it.
And it should be noted that this flyer, the flip side of it was entirely in Spanish, which Taryn was able to put together for us. So that was really nice because some of our targeted students were Spanish-speaking families.
We had one for elementary and also for mid.
Okay, and in step four, we identified our teachers and our spaces. So we had some teacher volunteers that had some passion for the program that volunteered at Cherry Lane Elementary, which was great. And then at the middle school, through retirement, a new hire was made for a teacher that had expertise in programs like these. And in terms of the space, you can see some pictures there. That's a big thank you to our building principals who helped us identify the spaces and redesign those learning spaces. The classrooms have a lot of technology. The teachers use their interactive whiteboards, their iPads, the Apple TV, as well as sound field systems in the rooms, which makes everything very clear. And as you can see, we have the hard and soft learning areas, the spaces, the furniture, as well as areas for small group, large group, and individual instruction. Okay, so they get set up in different spaces in the rooms with a teaching assistant and a teacher, and it flows real nice.
No.
I'll just take it.
Yeah, just so part of the curriculum and the materials that we brought in, one of them was this new program called Rethink. Rethink actually provides curriculum, it tracks student data, it provides staff with training. This has a whole training component within it. So all of the staff was trained in this particular program, as well as you can see up in the corner ABA, which stands for Applied Behavior Analysis. This is a methodology that helps to improve and shape behavior. We have our own BCBA that we utilize in the district, and she is still, up until this point, still providing providing training to the middle school and the elementary staff. For the middle school, we utilize Read 180 and Math 180. And this, what you see here, it's not exclusive to these programs. We actually use many other resources, but this is just a sampling of what we started off with. So again, all of the staff was required to be part of all of the trainings and all these programs that you see. I give much credit to all of the staff. This training started back in the spring. They came in over the summer. They stayed after school. They worked on their own at home. They really spent a lot of time learning these programs. And they even went to see similar programs in other districts as far as Jersey. So we really spent a lot of time doing background work. And then a little more on professional development. We did a week-long summer intensive program that focused on scaffolding techniques. Again, I had mentioned we have ongoing training from our BCBA consultant, Patricia McDonald. We had the Rethink implementation, RBT training, which is a registered behavioral technician. That's actually a training that you get certified in, and it's within the Rethink program. The CPI training, the crisis intervention, that's another program that staff got certified in. And last but not least, we had to ensure that not only the teachers of the program were trained in all of these, but the on-course staff, the related service providers, the teaching assistants, the aides, were all part of various components of these trainings to get these classes started.
Okay, so basically, Suffern Central has been able to introduce two new classes, of which we were able to bring back 16 students to their home district, which for families and those students is a very positive thing. And the projected tuition savings for those programs is $23,827.
So let's talk a little bit about PPS data, because while you're talking about that's a projected tuition savings, what did we really do with the budget this year? So in 16-17, we had 665 students with disabilities, 17-18, it's 684. That's really interesting because if you look at the referrals for 16-17, we had 83 in-district students referred, people that were already here, students who were already here. That's 2% of the population. That's actually a 28% decrease in referral rate. If you recall last year, this time when we spoke, we had a heavy RTI focus. We were using that to help decrease our referral rate because it had grown and skyrocketed. I showed you a video at the end with Melanie O'Keefe, the psychologist at Viola, who was going on and doing, working with each of the elementary schools on the referral rate. So we were really, really proud of the decrease in referral rate. And of that referral rate, only 36% of the referrals resulted in classification, which is again a decrease. We used to hover around 50%. We were at 36%. So the number classified was 30. We were very, very proud of that. They were good, strong classifications, and students were getting the assistance they needed at the RTI level as well. The number of SWDs still went up, however, even though about 50 graduate out each year. So why is that? It should have went down. Well, part of the issue is our transfers in. Last year, we had 33 students transfer in with IEPs. Of that, 10 of them are what we call out-of-district high cost. So to keep that in mind, those are students that are probably about in a placement of $50,000 a year or more. If they get a one-to-one aid or a monitor or like the bus with the monitor, the student may, that particular student's IEP may run the district more like 70 or 80, depending on the placement and how long the bus ride is, et cetera, et cetera. So we're doing what we can, much as transportation stated, with who we have in front of us, but we can't do anything about these other transfers in that are coming in. And so far this year, we have 24 transfers in, 5 of them are out of district high cost already. And we're only not even halfway through the year. So I'm not sure where that will go. So we need to keep that in mind when we look at any of the projected savings that we have. And we did a lot of work for that savings. So let's look at what the budget trend was over the past few years. In 14-15, it was a decreased budget.
15-16, we went up 2.56%. 16-17, which was a brutal year in special ed, we went up 9.99%. And then for this year, with all of the measures that we made and including in our new transfers in, we went down 1.07% for a budget that's actually below last year's projected budget at $11,322,332. And I should stop right here and just give credit to Taryn, who developed all of the graphs, this graph and the next one, because she's my graph expert, and to Sybil, who we hired for her mathematical ability, and who loves sharpened pencils, likely with mathematical ability, but interestingly enough, used my calculator that I have here, to figure out these numbers. These are percents. These are not that hard. And after she got done figuring them out on my calculator, her exact words were, "Can I go get my calculator? I don't trust yours." I said, "It's really bad enough that people don't trust me to calculate, but when you don't trust my calculator to calculate, I have a problem with that." Nonetheless, she did double check and all the numbers are correct. So as you can see, in the past few years, we've gone up tremendously in special ed. We worked very hard to actually have that number come in below. Let's see what that could have looked like, this year's number. So this is hard to read, but hypothetically. So the 15-16, 16-17, and 17-18, which are in red, are the projected amounts for the special ed budgets for those years. The black next to them are what we actually spent. So thank goodness that budget in 16-17 that had gone up so much, we actually came in much under. So we're very pleased with that. Last year's came in under, we actually, as well, our projected for this year is the $11,322,000. Right now we're on track to spend $11,121,000 and change. I can't predict, however, who's going to move in. So that would be an issue. So our savings should be this year an actual savings of about $122,000. So while we saved all that money in tuition by bringing 16 students back and having them in their buildings and participating in building activities, it was offset by some of the new students we had come in. The next three sets of columns are what would have happened had we not created the classes, just to give you guys a taste of that. So the blue is if we had gone up just the usual 2% that anyone could assume to go up because BOCES tuition and all the other tuitions at out-of-district placements go up about 2% a year. So that would have taken us at $11,673,000, and our budget as we did it, we would have saved $351,000 the way we came in. If the budget had actually gone up 4%, which is the average of what it did, if this will go back, these years, if you average these, except for this year's, if you average the 9.99, the 2.56, and 0.68, those percentages come out to be about 4%. So the purple tells you if we went up what we had gone up on average over the years, we would have been at $11,897,000. So this year's actual budget projected is a $575,000 savings. And had we gone up another 9.99%, which is the green line, we would be at this point over $12.5 million. So the work that we did saved $1,265,000 or so. So if it had continued unchecked without us building capacity within our district, that's what we would be looking at. So we're really proud of the classes that we opened. As we said before, it's early foundations and foundations. There are also a smattering of students that came back to the high school that are not in a set program with a name. That will increase next year as well. And look to see primary foundations next year also, which would be a K-2 program. The current early foundations is a 2-3-4. They will move up to 3-4-5, and we will have a K-1-2 class at Cherry Lane, depending on the incoming students. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
Great presentation. Lisa, you have some questions.
Yes.
Okay, so
clearly bringing students back into the district has great financial impacts. How are we evaluating? If you expect that question from me, our concerns are always the kids first. How have they performed? What feedback are we getting from the educators who are working with them, who've done a terrific job, you know, bringing them in-house, and also from their parents? Because there are parent concerns.
Right. So as Sybil mentioned, the feedback we've gotten so far has been tremendous. And these are students who, on Halloween, I watched them in their home school or in the district school participating in Halloween activities. We have two that are participating in the Suffern Middle School musical. The students are more than pleased. The parents are more than pleased. The teachers that are teaching these classes are tremendous. They're such vibrant places. If you want to go in and look, you really should. The feedback's been fabulous. The best way for us to judge long-term the impact is not just the budget. The way I envision it looking is 5 years from now, I'm going to go into that Indian Rock CBS and I'm going to see one of these students there. And we all are done, because this is my passion. When I walk around North Rockland, which is a much bigger district, so they could put together classes like this much easier. When I walk around North Rockland, I still go to the Stop and Shop and see students that were in programs such as this, and they're in there and they're working and they're seeing all the people that they grew up with. And everybody who comes in talks to them, hi, how are you doing? And it just increases the vibrancy of their life and their ability to meld into the fabric of the community. Because these are not students who are probably going to go to college and move away. These are students that are going to be here. We want them to be a part of the community they're going to be in and be, you know, engaged, active members of the community. The best way to do that is that they are seeing those same people. That, you know, you see your cohort of people, those same people even in school. The classes have just been wonderful to see, and that to me is the true judge of how well the classes are doing. I mean, the budgetary concerns are nice. It's really nice. It's nice to see that. But the real point is, what is it doing for the kids? And it's doing a tremendous amount for the kids at this point. We are always mindful of whatever New York State does with the graduation credentials or diplomas. These students are currently on track to probably get the CDAS credential, which is the career credential, and that would prepare them then to work in the community. So we're looking at that as well, and we'll be tracking how well they do on the assessments that lead them to the CDAS.
Is there a way that we're getting parent feedback as opposed to who volunteers to say this has been great, some organized way to actually get parent feedback on this?
We haven't organized any way as of yet. I mean, we're brand new. By the end of the year, we definitely can do that.
And I guess this segues into my other question regarding the steering committee that you're putting together.
Okay.
Who's going to serve on that? Is there, you know, parent?
At this point, all we've identified are the types of people we want on that. So parents, teachers, students, administrators, guidance, nurses, you know, all of the pieces of the community represented. There have not, no one specific as of yet.
So the Sherwood's dyslexia screener is already in play in our district, or is this something we're getting?
It's something we're getting. We're developing a protocol to screen for dyslexia. So the Sherwood's works for students who are K-1-2, maybe a little older, but that's it. So by two, I mean second grade, sorry. Kindergarten, first, second grade. After that, the protocol will mention the specific subtests of the Wyatt and the WISC that you use. Also, the DAS has some subtests we can use. So they are specific subtests related to letter word identification, reading fluency, oral reading, silent reading. We're putting that protocol together. It's based on the new New York State. I don't want to say it's a new regulation. It's a nuance of the regulation based on what the federal government has done as well. Dyslexia is now believed to be permissible to identify somewhat in the school district, which it never was before. So in response to that, we need to have a protocol together as to how we are doing that and what it looks like in our district. So we're working on that at this time.
How much time do we need to develop something that intricate?
Oh, dude, it's not that much. Probably by January or February it'll be done. Because the Sherwood's is in itself fine for K-1-2, which is the primary population we'd be using them.
And then how do we support dyslexic students? How are you going to support them?
We've always done what is the best practice, which is multisensory reading programs. So in this district, there's a cornucopia of those, and that's somewhat based on the need of the student and also based on the particular training of the faculty. So we have programs ranging from SPIRE, which is S-P-I-R-E, and it's an acronym, so they're all capitalized, which is a very, very easy training, and you just kind of follow it lockstep for students, and it would be kind of an upper tier two RTI training, to teachers who use OG, which is something we did two summers ago for groups of teachers, and that's both gen ed and special ed have it. And OG is a very individualized, extremely multisensory program. So it depends on the needs the student is presenting with. By that I mean, if you are one or two grade levels behind, depending on your age, you could probably start with SPIRE or use Wilson or Foundations or something like that. But if we start seeing students who are, let's say, four or five grades behind, which I have seen, you're going to use more of an OG because it's more intensive. But even a program such as Read 180 is actually multisensory. It uses computer programming, small group instruction, and whole group instruction to be multisensory as well. And it has that whole System 44 component, which is the 44 sounds of the English language. And that's the piece that really develops the dyslexic issues.
From my little knowledge of your very complicated area of work, the earlier the intervention, the better the outcomes, I would imagine. Dyslexia is definitely one of those where, you know, the sooner you identify and intervene, the better the results that you're going to get.
I want to say yes, but to be honest, I did my training with Diana Hanbury King. I'm not sure if you know who that is or not. One of the foremost OG people. She worked at like the Windward School and those sort of things. And I also trained with William Clavel, who was also her comrade. There is a body of thought, which is probably at least partially correct, that dyslexic students or even adults at times need to reach a level where they are ready for the training. So yes, we need to do it as much as we can, as early as possible, and it should help. But someone who's truly, truly dyslexic may need that continually until they hit that spot where it starts to click. So with all students, I'm sure if anybody's here who's an elementary teacher, sees that click with a child, that could happen much later with certain children. So it's something we're always judging and looking at. It's also possible at times, depending on what the particular impact is, for a student to be, you know, have decoding fine at a younger age, but then hit a snag when it comes to multisyllabic words and all of that. So then we would be putting a push on there. So it really depends on the student and how they're presenting, and it's different for everyone.
And the final part is, you know, obviously we've made great progress in terms of economic, you know, outcomes. Is that sustainable? What's the projection in the future?
Sustainable with the caveat that I cannot control who moves into the district. So our ability to create classes and create capacity is what holds down economically that piece of it for us. But at any given moment, someone can move in who's very high need. So that might overweight just a little bit.
Cannot project that.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Great work.
Thank you very much.
So currently, at the end of last week, we posted internally for a project-based learning coach, which will hereafter be called a PBL coach. It's just a little bit too long a word. And this position will provide job-embedded at-the-elbow support for teachers in all seven of our school buildings to expand their skill set with project-based learning. The anticipated start for this position will be September of 18. Project-based learning is the act of learning through identifying real-world problems and developing a solution for those problems. Consistent with the goal set forth in our strategic plan, PBL provides students authentic learning experiences, opportunities to pursue personal interests, and foster Suffern Central as a top-performing, innovative school district. We've met with success in providing job-embedded coaching to teachers in literacy, technology, and EML, and we believe that expanding the coaching model to include PBL will benefit our staff and our students. We believe PBL warrants this level of support as it's different than all other types of teaching in the way it strengthens the relationship between the teacher and the student. It really does this by destroying kind of the wall between teachers and students and replaces it with the teacher coaching and collaborating with students that really promotes the rapport. And we think that the support of a coach will really promote this shift sooner and smoother among our staff. And we anticipate the coaching to occur in a cohort model where the coach works with a cohort of staff to plan, implement, and then reflect on their projects. And we're confident that we'll be able to utilize the expertise of one of our own to provide the support to the staff.
Thank you.
You're
welcome.
Okay, what is the expected cost of this program?
The teacher salary.
It's an additional salary?
Well, that's why it's anticipated for September of 18. It'll be, we anticipate it being part of the budget we proposed to you for.
There's no other cost except, you know, funding a salary?
Nothing beyond like typical materials and stuff that teachers would want to do for projects.
And
PD.
And we just need a little bit more understanding of this program since it, you know, it involves an additional staff member. If you can maybe give them a more detailed presentation in the future so we have a better understanding of why we're bringing this to the district and what outcomes we hope to have.
Are you more interested in the coaching or the project-based learning?
The concept of problem-based learning.
There is a difference, and I'm sorry, I believe that's a typo up there. There are actually two schools of thought,
project-based learning,
and problem-based learning. We're a little more philosophically on the project-based learning side. Mm-hmm. I mean, to the outside world, they're not different. When you're actually doing them, there's some differences.
Okay, so yeah, so a little bit more of like a demonstration of what it is about, what we hope to accomplish with it. Thank you very much.
We did get information prior to regarding this.
Well, it'll be part of the it'll be part of our budget package.
Right.
So
excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's kind of cool. Okay, so we, I'm sorry, any other questions? No, okay. Public participation, this is public participation as to any school district business, not necessarily the action items. This session will last no longer than 30 minutes. If you have any comment with respect to any school district business, please step up to the podium, state your name, school affiliation, address your remarks to the board. You'll have 3 minutes to do so. And again, pursuant to policies 1230, 1400, 3240, please do not make any specific comments with respect to district personnel, staff, or student. Tired, aren't you? It was isolated, wasn't it? That transportation report. It was
my information using for schools.
All right, so at this time, I will close public participation portion of the meeting. Chairman, take a motion to adjourn. Oh, superintendent's comments, sorry. Dr. Adams.
It's late enough, but I hope everybody has very happy holidays and safe ones as well, and we'll see you back in January.
Exactly. This is our last meeting of the year, last regular scheduled meeting of the year. Again, on behalf of the Board of Ed, thank you for coming. For all those in the social or the social media world watching this on tape, have a wonderful, wonderful break. Whatever you celebrate, enjoy your family and friends, and just be safe. Thank you. Motion adjourned. Yeah. All in favor, Monty, Paul, all in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. Aye. A